Notice that I'm not Paul Rundquist at the same time. Paul will not be able to join us tonight, so we're really sorry about that, especially in terms of his expertise. But unfortunately, he simply won't be able to join us. So we're going to change the format a little bit. It's going to be about the road to the White House and the elections, and we'll have lots of time for discussion. But the format we'll have is I'm going to start with a 30, 45-minute analysis of the election, what I see as the main issues, and engage that. And then we have lots of time for all the questions that you have and the discussion that you would like to have. So the theme is the same. We'll have a very lively discussion and talk about what's going to happen in the next 5 days, but also really what this election is about in a larger sense in terms of American politics and society and how the landscape is really changing. But also, let's make no mistake about that, how this American election is very much a transatlantic and global election. A lot of the themes are similar. We have national elections in Germany and in France next year, and many of the themes we see playing out in the United States right now will be at the heart and center of German and French post-industrial globalized societies and how voters are reacting to these basic themes. So, road to the White House. It seemed relatively straight and clear for Hillary Clinton about 4 days ago. And that shows you, you know, the phrase we have in American politics, October surprise, has now been also edited and changed in terms of American politics. Now we're allowed to talk about November surprise. In the sense of the very last days of American politics. And it's a dramatic headline if we think about what has happened in the last couple of days in terms of the FBI, a federal institution, supposed to be nonpartisan in a perfect world, of course. But when we see with FBI Director Comey launching a letter to Congress, talking federally about possibilities of incorrect behavior, as President Obama said, rumors about possibilities and what this means for this election season. We see a large theme in American society that maybe is not as present in Western Europe, namely how American institutions have become so polarized, even those that are meant to serve as national binding institutions. In a way, FBI Director Comey has dropped a bomb into the political process. We see the most recent polls showing it's getting tighter in terms of overall public opinion. I'll talk about what that means in terms of the Electoral College. But for many Europeans, it seems difficult to understand how Hillary Clinton and Donald Trump can be so close in opinion polls after everything we've heard from the Republican candidate. And when we look at what Hillary Clinton seems to represent in terms of intelligence, experience, moderation, strength, and courage. And I will talk to that, how we look at that puzzle. How can so many Americans be willing to vote for a candidate like Donald Trump? I'll say right now, I don't have a problem with that. It's a democratic process. If we have a problem with voters voting for Donald Trump, we have a problem with democracy. In the sense that democracy doesn't mean my democracy. Democracy means the people govern. That's the Greek roots of the word, demos and katsia. So this is what we're really experiencing in the United States now in terms of democracy, and we can debate that. We can debate that. I will say this, I'm awfully glad America has a Wahlmännersystem, an electoral college. The electoral college was designed in part to keep the Donald Trumps out of the White House. And there's a good chance it will be the Electoral College that indeed does that. And we can talk about that in terms of different institutions. The electoral system is, the Electoral College system is less democratic than parliamentary systems in certain ways, but it also maybe allows for less radicalization of democracies by keeping certain parties out of national legislators. But we can debate that. That's a controversial statement. If we look at some of the initial voting that's taking place, we're seeing some worrying signs for Hillary Clinton. So as you know, Americans can mail in their ballots. I did mine 2 weeks ago for the state of the Republic of California, where I am a registered voter, I had three ballots, three big ballots that I had to fill in. One for the national elections, where I could see the different candidates, Green Party, Libertarian Party. There I saw Donald Trump and Pence there. It's probably no secret, I skipped over that line. I found Clinton and Kane and put my little arrow next to that, connected the arrow. Then I had a ballot for the state of California and the Republic of California. We had a senator to vote for, members of the House of Representatives. That's also very important to remember in this electoral season. One-third of the U.S. Senate is up for election. The entire House of Representatives is up for re-election every 2 years. So the congressional outcomes will be very important in terms of the road to the White House. Will determine very importantly what a president can do in any way. And then I had in my California ballot, I had 19 referenda that I had to decide on. In other words, the Constitution of the Republic of California is based on Swiss democracy. So Swiss immigrants played a key role in shaping the institutional history of California. So I had 19 issues to vote on. Marijuana, condoms for the pornography industry. I'm not joking. My 14-year-old daughter helped me with that one. What else was on the ballot? Plastic bags. There was two issues on plastic bags. School funding. 19 issues. So the Republic of California, we believe in populist democracy. The ability to challenge elites established through referenda to go around the structures of elite politics. And you know from German society, there's a difficult debate around this issue about what do referenda do for the type of democracy we want, the stability of democracy, how much power do we really give directly to the people to decide on important issues. And in the United States, different states have different constitutions handling these issues in different ways. And that gives you a sense of the different traditions of democracy just within the United States. African-American voters seem to be, right now we see this from mail-in ballots like mine, and I think perhaps another colleague from the Republic of California. Sounds like you voted also in California. We're seeing from early mail-in ballots, for example, among African-American voters, that they are surprisingly ambivalent about Hillary Clinton. Barack Obama has changed his schedule for this week to go talk to electoral districts where African-Americans are strongly represented, using a combination of motivation and stern lectures, making it clear to voters that not turning out is also a vote. Is a type of vote for Donald Trump, and they need to be clear about what staying at home means. And he's not afraid to compare and contrast what happened with the Brexit vote and those who were against Brexit but just didn't show up on voting day and what that meant for the outcome. So we see already a shift taking place between Barack Obama and the African American vote and what this will mean. And the nervousness in the Clinton team. All elections are about two things all the time, whether it's Germany or the United States. One is to convince an individual, a voter, to support you intellectually, to make that decision in their mind. And then also, of course, to mobilize that voter on election day to actually go vote for you. And this is what we're really seeing in the next few days now. Both teams spending enormous amounts of money and energy to actually get voters to the booth. And many times this could involve literally going to senior citizen homes and driving voters to the election offices, making sure they have a way to get there, especially in rural communities and small towns where people are more isolated. It comes down to these things in many key states, actually getting people to the voting booths. So Barack Obama and Michelle Obama are speaking to African American and other minority communities throughout this week. They have an intense travel schedule to mobilize voters, to convince them to go vote. Hillary Clinton is spending a lot of time among female voters, especially in urban spaces, to mobilize, to reassure urban female voters, especially young professionals and women professionals in different stages. They have to vote. They have to vote and consolidate that. That might seem obvious to this audience. Of course you go vote on election day. But you know from your own elections, because you have the right to vote, does not mean you will vote. Some countries, you are fined if you do not vote. You're breaking the law. You can have a philosophical debate about that, if it should be breaking the law if you don't vote. Different countries handle this in different ways. Very important the next week for the Hillary Clinton team is also to mobilize Hispanic voters. Hispanic voters, as you know, Hispanics, Latinas, and Latinos are a larger minority in American society than African Americans by now. African Americans are about 13-14% of the American population. Latinas and Latinos, 17-18-19, rapidly heading towards 20% of the American population. You take these two populations, add Asian Americans, about 6-7% of American population, and you do the math and you see how notions of minorities are increasingly important for American politics and will only continue to be so. Very important also for Hillary Clinton is to mobilize white voters, especially white male voters. This is what we tend to think is sort of Donald Trump's core constituency, white working class voters. Indeed, this is a strong part of his constituency, but it was also a strong and core constituency for Bernie Sanders. And indeed, Bernie Sanders and Donald Trump during the primary season often did best in those electoral districts where you had a clear predominance of a white working class, parts of Ohio, parts of Michigan, parts of Wisconsin. And in these districts, Bernie Sanders is now, especially in this week now, starting tomorrow actually, going to be on the road constantly for Hillary Clinton. He's been relatively absent the last few weeks, and people have wondered how committed he really was to seeing a Democrat in the White House, to have Hillary Clinton win. He has strong personal and intellectual reservations about Hillary Clinton, but he's also a pragmatic person and realizes that by not engaging his energy to mobilize the white working class and young voters, many of you in the room here tonight, young voters could stay home on election day as well, which would be very difficult for Hillary Clinton. This is, for example, exactly what we saw with Brexit. Young voters in Great Britain particularly stayed home, said, I'm not for Brexit, but I don't really understand the issues and I don't feel really directly involved somehow. It's not worth it for me to make my way to the polling booth. If a lot of young voters, a lot of young women say that about Hillary Clinton, that's another problem for her. So you see, I'm adding up quite a list of genuine challenges for Hillary Clinton in the next 5 days. This is really the period where, as we say in American English, the rubber hits the road. This is where it really counts. And if we look at Hillary Clinton's coalition, African Americans, Latinas, Latinos, Asian Americans, women, working class in part, young voters, there is a big question mark to what extent this coalition will actually go vote on election day. Awfully tempted by the thought, my one vote really doesn't make a difference. We're talking about millions of votes. One vote's not going to really matter that much. That is the great danger for Hillary Clinton right now. How Donald Trump potentially can sneak into the White House, the way Brexit sneaked past the final line and actually became the winning vote in British politics. That possibility is absolutely not excluded from next Tuesday. That's a genuine possibility, depending on voter turnout. That is absolutely essential. And the early signs, frankly, are mixed in terms of voter mobility and turning out to actually vote for Hillary Clinton. What you say to a pollster is one thing. Where you put your X and actually get up and do that is something quite different. Also worrying for the Hillary Clinton team is the third party movement. So Democrats, interestingly, it's a two-party, generally a two-party society, because institutionally, in terms of presidential elections, the Electoral College encourages a two-party system. But the big danger for Hillary Clinton is that young voters will say, I'll vote. Obviously, I'm not voting for Donald Trump, but I can't vote for Hillary Clinton. So maybe I'll vote, for example, for the Green Party and Jill Stein and her party. Perfectly valid, democratic right, and a serious choice to be made. So young voters, Bernie Sanders voters, many are attracted to the Green Party and Jill Stein and her message. Older Democrats and some young Democrats, but certainly sort of the so-called 68 generation, are attracted to the Libertarian Party and Gary Johnson. So the Libertarian Party sort of says, stay out of my pocket, stay out of my bedroom. And for example, much of the Silicon Valley scene, the tech scene, is very interested in the Libertarian Party. It represents sort of a tech utopia, minimal state, sort of swarm democracy, a little bit like the Pirate Party in Iceland, what we saw there. So the Libertarian Party represents this kind of spirit. And so many well-to-do, middle-class Democratic voters are looking very closely at the Libertarian Party. And we need to remember, 2000, Florida, and the decisive votes that allowed George W. Bush to enter the White House was not just about the Supreme Court. It was also about Ralph Nader and a third party movement, taking sufficient votes away from Albert Gore to allow sufficient support for George W. Bush. This is the challenge, depending on your politics, and the danger, if you're a Hillary Clinton supporter, of third parties. And it's difficult for young voters. Do I vote pragmatically to bring Hillary Clinton into office, who I feel indifferent about? Or do I vote my head to a certain way? Or do I vote really what I am believing and I find more promising, my heart, if you will, and vote Green Party or Libertarian Party? And by doing that, potentially, if we're honest with ourselves, make it perhaps easier for Donald Trump to win the election. That is a genuine choice that many American voters, especially voters of your age, face right now in terms of this election and how they will cast their ballot. The choice is real. It's no longer theoretical in 5 days. People have to make a concrete choice. We have swing states again for this season, and the swing states are getting tighter in the last few days. And the so-called swing states, in other words, states that can be critical for an electoral college win or not, are getting closer. And there's certain states I'll spend a little bit of time on to give you a sense of where American politics is and maybe how this election will be decided. One is one that most of you know, the state of Ohio. No Republican, for example, has made it to the White House since World War II without winning the state of Ohio. And right now, Donald Trump has a slight lead in terms of the popular vote in the state of Ohio, according to the latest polls. It's a thin margin, but at a minimum, we can say it is extremely close in the state of Ohio. How do we explain that? Well, if you look at Ohio as a microcosm of much of American society, you begin to see some answers about how this election season has shaped up as it has and what it means for where America's going looking down the road. Hillary Clinton is doing very well in those areas that Barack Obama did very well in, namely large urban centers, large areas in terms of ethnic and cultural diversity, such as Cleveland, or Cincinnati, or Columbus, as large urban areas. If you look at the maps, you'll see over the last 12 years, Democrats more or less always taking large urban areas in Midwest states, post-industrial states, if you will, and Republicans cleaning up in small town rural Ohio. where you have less ethnic diversity, you have thinner populations, you have a greater sense of sort of the unraveling of the fabric of local communities. That's a feeling that is very strong. So cities oftentimes can give you a victory in a state. Take Virginia, for example. Virginia is a southern state. And yet Barack Obama won Virginia twice. But if you look at the electoral map of Virginia, what you'll see is he lost every small town, rural county. Everyone. All went Republican. What he did win was the university towns, and especially the area of Alexandria, Virginia. Alexandria, Virginia is close to Washington, D.C. It's what we call in the United States a bedroom community. In other words, Washington, D.C.'s middle class, well-educated civil servant class commutes from Alexandria, Virginia into Washington, D.C. for work. So Alexandria is an upscale, confident, well-educated community. And there, Barack Obama did very well. That's how he took Virginia as a southern state. He took, geographically, if you just look at the map, you'd think he was crushed in Virginia. It's a sea of red. But the density of the urban vote in certain areas of Virginia meant, in terms of actual voter numbers, he was able to win the southern state of Virginia. The challenge with Ohio is it's built more evenly in terms of urban centers and rural and small town communities, thus making it very close. Now, it is possible that Donald Trump takes Ohio but loses the election. Again, that's just the nature of the electoral season. And that has to do with the fact that Donald Trump and his message has really upended much of the political map in the United States, changed a lot of the rules. We'll have to see what happens with other key states, such as Florida, for example, another major one. Florida is also very close. And shows you really how complicated American politics is. So there is a very large, for example, Jewish vote in Florida. So I hear oftentimes get questions, what about the Jewish vote in America? I say, well, first of all, there is no Jewish vote. Right? There's many Jews in Florida who support Donald Trump. There's many Jews in Florida who are passionate about Bernie Sanders. And there's many Jews in Florida who are strong supporters of Hillary Clinton. So in American politics, we often say, tell me your Postleitzahl, tell me your zip code, and I'll tell you your politics. Right? Based on sort of mundane, tell me what you eat, and I'll tell you who you are. So Florida is very much a zip code state. In other words, you have progressive Jewish communities living in certain clusters. You have very conservative Jewish communities living in certain clusters, certain zip codes. Same thing with the Latina-Latino vote. The Latina-Latino vote in Florida is not overwhelmingly Mexican-American. It's Cuban-American. And Cuban-American votes, depending on generations, can be very conservative, very conservative. Younger Cubans tend to be more willing to be Democratic, but middle-aged to older Cubans tend to clearly be Republican, especially in terms of foreign policy. Strong anti-communism, embargo on Cuba, whatever you want to think about that, but embargo politics. And so we have many Jewish voters, many Cuban voters who are Trump supporters in Florida. You don't hear that story often. That shows you the complexity and the diversity of American politics. How about my state, my home state of California? It most likely is going to go for Hillary Clinton. As a matter of fact, I think we can call California already. I'm going to go out on a limb and say California has been a Democratic state in terms of presidential politics for quite some time. And in many ways, you can argue California shows you, in terms of the next 5 to 10 to 15 years, where American politics is going. Indeed, in terms of the White House, things look good for the Democrats. And California gives you some reasons why. California as a state now is a so-called minority-majority state. There is no clear ethnic majority anymore in California. Our election material is available, I think, in 27 languages or something like this, officially. You can get it in everything from Mandarin to Tagalog, Thai, Hmong, Spanish and English, etc., etc. Everything comes in Spanish and English now, automatically in California. Even the ballot is in Spanish and English. It's a de facto a bilingual state, if you will, like Canada in terms of French and English. But California is also a complicated state. There are a lot of Trump supporters in California, the so-called progressive state. It depends which part of California you're talking about. So if you go to Northern California, above San Francisco and above Sonoma County and wine country, to really rural, small town California, you have a lot of white poverty, former logging communities, mining communities. There's a lot of Trump support in Northern California. There's a lot of Trump support in Central California, away from the coast, small town, conservative towns, ranching towns that are distrustful of the notion of a large state and Hillary Clinton's policies. Southern California has strong pockets of support for Donald Trump, right around Los Angeles, Orange County, for example, a home of conservative politics. Really, the California you know and sort of see and that supports Hillary Clinton and represents enough votes is the so-called coastal California, San Francisco, Los Angeles, parts of San Diego. But they have such dense populations, Silicon Valley overall, although you help me understand this, the German-American venture capitalist, Peter Thiel, has come out and supported Donald Trump. So it shows you how complicated these issues are in terms of politics. But overall, in terms of demography, California will turn towards, will most likely go for Hillary Clinton, although it's a much more complicated state than we see. So what do we see at play here in the next 5 days? Overall, in terms of the country, in terms of other swing states, we see regional clusters. I'll talk about that a little bit more. We see demographic patterns. And we see keys for the future of American politics. So what are the regional clusters? One that's very important in terms of this election, is it gives us a sense of where the country is going, is in the West, namely Colorado and Nevada. So we think small states, not really known for a lot. But what these states really show is we see a large surge of immigrants coming in, especially in terms of Latina and Latino voters. We see university towns. We see new industries coming in. And we see old pockets of conservative cultures from the 50s and 60s that in many ways are strong Republican voters. But as states like Colorado and Nevada increasingly diversify and modernize, they're going to be more and more inclined to be Democratic states. We have the new West, if you will. We see a new Western pattern beginning to emerge outside of California. We have the new South, states like Virginia and North Carolina. Hillary Clinton will be in North Carolina tomorrow, along with Michelle Obama, along with Bernie Sanders. All three will be in North Carolina tomorrow. Donald Trump will be in North Carolina tomorrow. North Carolina is a so-called bellwether southern state. In other words, North Carolina shows a lot of the patterns of how the South is changing. Our notion of it's in the South, it must be conservative, is really outdated. And that has to do with economic change. That has to do with demographic change. That has to do with different things that are happening to make many southern states potentially states where, in terms of presidential elections, the Democrats have very good chances. We have the cluster of Wisconsin and Michigan. In other words, states that were strong industry states, much of the industry has left. And there's an insecure working class. Bernie Sanders will spend a lot of time in Wisconsin and Michigan. Trying to convince the white working class or the working class per se to vote for Hillary Clinton. And we'll see what happens there. Right now, Hillary Clinton has a small lead in Wisconsin and Michigan, but Donald Trump will also spend their time to try to also consolidate his base among the working class. Okay, so what is motivating voters in these last days? There's a combination of things that are motivating voters. Important to note is apathy. And we've never had a season like this where so many voters, two-thirds of the voters, dislike the two main candidates. You have to think about that. 65% of the voters say, I don't like either candidate. That is something to really think about and chew on in terms of what the parties as institutions are doing in terms of the candidates they introduce. So apathy, as I talked about at the beginning, is an important variable in the next few days. Habit will play a large role in the next 2 days. Many voters vote a party simply because that's what they voted and that's what they believe in. And this accounts for an important part for Donald Trump's support. I've always voted Republican and I will continue to vote Republican. I cannot see myself voting for a Democrat. A German journalist, Jochen Bittner from Die Welt, introduced a new word into the American political season, der Wutbürger. So he wrote a piece for the New York Times where he tried to explain to an American audience what a Wutbürger is. And the notion of fury, not frustration, not anger, but Wut, rage, rage at the system, is something that is also going to play a clear part in the final days of the election. This is something that helps Donald Trump. Those voters, if you look at deeper into the polls, how people support, why people support Donald Trump, you'll find rational answers. Again and again and again, as people answer a series of questions, they'll say, I find Donald Trump profoundly troubling as a person. But I have voted Republican and establishment the last 20 years, and I have seen hardly any changes in my community. In my opportunity in this part of the country. I don't know what to do anymore. So my answer is to throw a bomb into the system, and that bomb's name is Donald Trump. I know it's going to damage a lot of things. I know it's problematic. I don't know what else to do. Wutbürgertum, in a way, in a sense of almost an anarchist instinct to somehow blow up the system, to somehow try to see what we can do to change the system. And that sort of rage, if you will, in part motivated a lot of voters in terms of Bernie Sanders, but especially motivates supporters of Donald Trump. We see a lot of identity politics, and we see especially the Hillary Clinton team trying to mobilize identity politics in terms of race and gender. In class, a type of class narrative. Right? Donald Trump is trying to motivate another class narrative. Donald Trump doesn't have a lot to say on gender and race. He does, but it's not having much of a mobilizing impact right now in terms of the election. That part is clearly a strength for Hillary Clinton. One politician who is clearly popular among Americans is Barack Obama. His approval ratings are going up notably, week by week. They're around 57% right now. Very strong numbers, around the numbers that Ronald Reagan had, for example, when he left office back in the late 1980s. That was not always the case for Barack Obama. Shows you how even American voters understand context, and when they look at the entire political map, I think they're beginning to already mourn the fact that Barack Obama's days are numbered. He's always been very popular personally, in terms of a person, his numbers have always been in the 60 percentiles. Two-thirds of the Americans like him personally, find him, you know, in terms of integrity and who he is as a person, worthy of the White House. Clear majority. 65% means not just Democrats, it means independent voters, it even means Republicans see him as such. 57% means Democrats, and many, if not most, so-called independent voters find that Barack Obama currently is doing a good job. And if we look at his coalition, Barack Obama's coalition and the support he gets, and think about that in terms of Hillary Clinton in the last days, a group we kind of all know and assume Barack Obama does well among African Americans, that he does well among minorities. What we tend to forget is that Barack Obama also always did very well among white working class voters. As well as, for example, Bill Clinton did as a Southern governor from Arkansas in the 1990s, as well as Jimmy Carter did way back in the 1970s as a Southern governor from the state of Georgia. So Barack Obama was able to appeal to white working class with a convincing narrative in terms of national politics. Hillary Clinton has had a much harder job in terms of that. There's different theories about why that is. She's a woman. And for the white male working class, they have, to put it politely, complicated feelings around that. But of course, you could say that about Barack Obama being an African American, too. And yet he did, as I said, just as well as white presidential candidates, Bill Clinton from the South, Jimmy Carter from the South, as they did, as an African American. So it's hard to say really where the answer is. What I'd like to do is talk a couple minutes about the possible implications of the election, because there is an enormous choice here at stake, and this is sort of the bridge to the transatlantic space and to Europe. We have with Donald Trump and Hillary Clinton two clear, distinct, and different narratives. And I would argue these two clear, distinct narratives are the same narratives before which German voters will be standing next year and French voters. We're just experiencing it in an American context right now. And I'd like to spend a little time talking about that. First, Trumpism, Donald Trump, and what he stands for. Trump loses the election, Trump is not going away. Trump is simply the barometer measuring a political and societal storm. He's more a symptom than a cause of anything. And you can call his narrative nationalist populism. And there's a clear contour to it in terms of, and it's emerging from different variables. I won't spend time talking about this so we can have a conversation. This nationalist populism is emerging from the insecurities in American society caused by economic transformation, identity politics, even notions of race and society. And we can talk more about that. And Trumpism, or this nationalist populist narrative, cuts across all through American society. It involves old and young. It involves academia and the so-called working class. Because you have a university degree does not mean you're immune to populism. On the contrary. And we see that throughout Europe and certainly in the United States. It involves women and men. Nationalist populism is very attractive to many female voters. This is not about unemployed males. That is part of the clientele. It's just a fraction of the clientele. The clientele is much larger than that. We see that in the studies coming from Europe, coming from the United States. And nationalist populism is a rightist movement. It's also very clearly a leftist movement. A lot of nationalist populist support comes from the left. We see that in terms of the AfD and Die Linke in Germany. We see that in terms of unions and the loss of union voters to Donald Trump in American politics. Union leader after union leader in the United States, especially in Ohio, for example, cities like Canton or Youngstown, former large steel towns. And I was reading a series of interviews with union leaders from these two cities earlier today. They say, our union members tell us they're going to vote for Hillary Clinton, but when we're not around and we eavesdrop on their conversations, we hear a lot of Donald Trump. A lot of Donald Trump. So nationalist populism is leftist and rightist. It is old and young. It is women and men. It is well-educated, university-educated, and less educated. In this sense, nationalist populism and what Trump stands for is a broad societal movement that is emerging out of the disruptions of economic transformation, identity politics, and overall anxiety about where the country is going. Clinton stands for a strongly different narrative, what we can call international progressivism. And you have this message as well. Angela Merkel, for example, and Hillary Clinton are strikingly similar in many ways in terms of their personalities, political personalities, and in terms of their politics. and this movement as well, in terms of Hillary Clinton, is one that's also at the heart of society. It involves well-educated, working class, women, men, old, young, left, right. You might say Hillary Clinton and the right, really? Many Republicans are going to vote for Hillary Clinton, not just because they don't believe in Donald Trump as a person, or they don't believe in his nationalist populist message either. They don't believe in the content of his politics. So centrist Republicans are looking to the Democratic Party, not for the first time. That's happened in the past as well. Many centrist Republicans voted, for example, for Barack Obama as well. So party loyalty in the United States is relatively fluid for at least important parts of American society. And these two different messages will have profound implications for American politics depending on who wins in the first 100 days. Now, just to give you a sense of what a Donald Trump victory would mean in the so-called first 100 days of the American politics. It would mean, first of all, TTIP and TPP are dead. So maybe that's a good thing. But it would mean, in a way that we haven't seen since World War II, the end of America's effort to try to encourage a type of economic, global economic system, and one that many partners are interested in. It would mean America's alliance politics, whether with Japan or especially with Germany in terms of NATO, would also be strongly questioned. And in terms of immigration, Donald Trump would act on that very quickly. One of the first things he would do, I would predict. Donald Trump wins. He's not winning just for the fun of it. He's an ambitious person, as we know, which means he would need to position himself early in his administration for re-election. And the only way he's, as a populist, as a nationalist populist, is going to have a chance for re-election is to fulfill his promises, is to pursue what he promised. A much more nationalist foreign policy, a much more nationalist immigration policy, a much more nationalist economic policy. Really, Donald Trump would introduce for the United States, in terms of international politics, a strategy, an approach the world has not seen since World War II. Saw it in the 1920s and the 1930s, but has not seen it since. And Donald Trump would, I would predict, quickly in his first 100 days make clear that's exactly what his strategy is. That's what his voters voted for, he would say. And in many ways, he's absolutely right. If Hillary Clinton wins, I think we'll see also in these main areas politics that will move forward. In terms of trade, I think she would begin to relativize her discussion. She would bring in a different type of way to approach trade. She would spend a lot more on social policy to try to relativize the costs of trade. This is the big effect of Bernie Sanders and Senator Elizabeth Warren from Massachusetts. The standard line in American politics is third parties generally don't make it to the White House, but they can have a substantial influence on the two main parties. And in terms of Bernie Sanders and Elizabeth Warren, you clearly see this with the Democratic Party. They have made Hillary Clinton's message more social democratic, if you will, to put it in a European context. And she will focus very early on, I would predict, on social policy. For example, Obamacare. Donald Trump would do everything he could, depending on the majority he has in Congress, it could be close, to dismantle Obamacare. Whereas Hillary Clinton would do everything she could to sort of reform and strengthen Obamacare. On immigration, Hillary Clinton would more or less do what Barack Obama has done. Barack Obama has deported far more so-called illegal immigrants from the United States than George W. Bush ever did. And so Hillary Clinton would continue with that. But at the same time, she would also push very strongly for new immigration law to make it perhaps more humane and more progressive. And in terms of alliances, she would support really the transatlantic order that we have. Okay, last thing. I want to leave you with a provocative thought. And then just tell me how wrong I am. So it's clear Donald Trump is radioactive, toxic. In terms of public space, indiscutable. Right? In many ways, his performance is taboo in terms of German politics. So if you asked, here's my hypothesis. If you asked Germans publicly, who would you vote for, Hillary Clinton or Donald Trump? About 65% of German voters would say for Hillary Clinton. It's much lower than Barack Obama 8 years ago. But about 35% of German voters would say, well, I would look at Donald Trump. How did I come to 35%? Well, if you add up all the AfD support and Linke support and the nationalist populist support in German politics, you come to around 35%. Same thing you have in France. Same thing you have in Great Britain. Now, how would German voters vote privately? In other words, if they had the chance to close the curtain behind them and vote Hillary Clinton or Donald Trump. My prediction there would be Donald Trump 52%, Hillary Clinton, 48%. How the heck did I come to that conclusion? Let's look at Donald Trump's main issues. Let's take trade policy. Hillary Clinton believes clearly, although she's relativized her message, in TTIP and TPP. Donald Trump has said unequivocally he will kill both as soon as he can. Look at German opinion polls. Ask Germans what they think about CETA or TTIP. It's quite clear where the majority is. Let's take Einwanderungspolitik. Donald Trump has said very clearly, open borders is a disaster for our country. It has got to stop. We have got to get control of our borders again. Look at German opinion polls. What do Germans think about the notion of being in control of your borders and managing and controlling immigration? It's clear where the majority opinion is. Take the NATO alliance. Donald Trump has said on NATO, it's a useless, outdated alliance, and this Article 5, where we're all supposed to support each other, don't get that. German opinion polls, over 60% of Germans say Article 5 is highly dubious and they don't know if they support it or not. That is the backbone of NATO. Without Article 5, for example, Eastern Europe, NATO has no purpose for members from the eastern part of the country. And then lastly, take leadership, notions of global leadership and responsibility. Donald Trump says, look, Putin has the right to pursue Russian interests in his neighborhood. And the Chinese have the right to pursue their interests in their neighborhood. We have no right to tell them what to do. These are strong leaders working in the name of their people. Right? Angela Merkel and Hillary Clinton say, we have a moral obligation to speak to power, to hold a notion of Rechtsstaat. We support sanctions. Do a majority of Germans support sanctions? Clearly not. Right? If you could hold a referendum on sanctions and Russia tomorrow, Germany would have a strongly different policy, according to German opinion polls. Germany would have a Donald Trump approach to Russia. So if we look at the content of Donald Trump's message on trade, on immigration, on alliances, and on definitions of global leadership, if you look at German opinion polls, a slight majority or a notable majority of Germans agree with the content of Donald Trump's message. The content, not the performance, not the personality. And as my closing remark, what I want to say is Trumpism is an American phenomenon, but it's really a transatlantic moment in terms of our democracies, notions of liberal democracies. And next year we'll see how France and Germany engage many of the same themes around core issues of how we organize our societies domestically and in terms of global politics. Okay, thanks for your patience. Now we have time for questions and debate and critique. Thank you. So just raise your hand and I'll take your questions and, yes, sir. So the question was, in the Senate race in California, there's actually two Democrats on the ballot. There's not a Republican, and indeed that's correct. So is that Democratic or is that totalitarian? I don't know if I'd call it totalitarian. If it's, the state is clearly Democratic. I mean, let's put it this way. The Democratic Party didn't exclude the Republican Party from the ballot. The Republican Party has an enormously difficult future in the state of California. Arnold Schwarzenegger was a Republican, the governor. And he was popular, even among Democrats. So he was a populist in terms of his style and his message. But at the end of the day, he was a moderate Republican. Ronald Reagan came from California. He was also a moderate Republican. Ronald Reagan really built the institution in the state of California, the log cabin Republicans, that allowed for the first time in the United States for gays to be open and part of the Republican Party, have their own coalition, their own interest group. And that was Ronald Reagan, and that happened in California. So California has by the very nature of the state, progressive, if not populist, Swiss democracy, has been a state with high political mobility. And that has made it challenging for many Republicans in terms of finding a real, there's been pockets of real conservative politics. But right now, the Republican Party in California, in many ways, reflects the Republican Party in the country, deeply divided, a type of civil war within the party. And when the party is so deeply divided, it's very hard to coalesce around a candidate and build a narrative that's going to mobilize a large number of voters. So I agree with you, it's problematic. It's not healthy for the for democracy, obviously. But on the other hand, it also represents many of the challenges the party has. And then what is the Republican narrative even for California, let alone for the rest of the country? Other questions or critique? I tried to provoke with my closing. I hope that. It's a very interesting observation. So the question about how notions of party loyalty act as a type of blocking agent in disallowing voters to perhaps shift their allegiances in terms of voting behavior to other party milieus or other party choices. I would say absolutely an accurate observation, and studies show that. As we know from different political philosophers or sociologists, human beings are creatures of habit, and getting beyond habit is always a challenge for us. You know, another word used is milieus, right? A religious milieu, a union milieu, a party milieu, depending on where we grow up and what sort of different sort of sociological, religious, political, ideological milieus, and moving beyond that. Longer term, if we compare, let's say, you know, today compared to the 50s and 60s, we see steady and ongoing breaking down of that taking place. So, you know, in the 50s and 60s, whether it was American society or West Germany, for example, if you lived in a certain neighborhood or worked in a certain factory, it was kind of obvious or place, you know, most likely how you voted or what church you went to or what have you. A lot of that, for your generation, for example, a young generation, you're much freer that way. You're less blocked. So in this political season, though, we have, as you point out, genuine difficult choices. I think voters are struggling deeply with personal and public costs of possible choices. That's what I try to outline very briefly. In terms of the purity of the Green Party and Jill Stein's message or Bernie Sanders' message, powerful for many voters, right? And so personal conviction, one remains true to personal conviction, which is enormously important for our sense of integrity and sense of citizenship and how we see we can contribute to a society. So what do you do with the, also, somehow you do understand the point that if you voted for Ralph Nader in Florida in 2000, you felt good, but possibly you were part of the opposition coming to power. Some, you can ignore that, you can dismiss that, that's your good right, but what do you do with that? So you're right, habits are blocking certain types of behavior, but I think generally in this political season, it's genuinely complicated for voters in terms of the choices. They have real and stark and profound choice between the two candidates. And that's why I try to outline the end between the notion of international progressivism and national populism. Each candidate, I mean, die Wahl gilt. There is a true, clear, if politische Verdrossenheit or apathy is about, I see no difference between the candidates. That is not the case in this electoral season, at least in America. Other questions, things I did not talk about, things to critique, other issues? Yes? So a good question. If Donald Trump wins, how will that impact his foreign policy, let's say, in terms of the Middle East and in terms of Asia? In terms of the Middle East, he has an inherently contradictory message. On the one hand, he would ramp up the military power. If you listen to, you know, his foreign policy advisors and his vice presidential candidate. On the other hand, he says on the next day, it's a local problem. It's not our job to clean up. He would get rid of the deal with Iran immediately. How he would do that, who knows? So if you listen to him long enough, I don't say this sarcastically. If you just take him seriously and listen to what he says and read transcripts, you see he's really, I think, trying to mobilize different clientele for himself, different components of protests and Republican voters. So Republican voters who believe in a very sort of so-called Vulcan or hawk type of foreign policy, you know, where you show strength. And he's always talking about strength, right? Putin is a strong leader. He shows strength. So how does Putin show strength in Syria? Well, we see how he does that. So and Trump admires that. But on the other hand, he has a very strong populist vote, and this was also the case of Bernie Sanders. It says it's not our business whatsoever to be showing strength anywhere. Syria is Syria's problem. China is China's problem. Let's take care of home first. So the point is, Trump's message is strongly isolationist and strongly revisionist at the same time. That's very hard to bring together. That's a classic sign of a populist message, by the way. That you have inherent contradictions in your message, but your voters are so frustrated or so filled with fury, they're willing to see beyond that. Hear what they want, and they hear overall a message of defiance and change that is seductive. Populists are never consistent in terms of their logic. They're appealing to different clientele and try to bring them together. And I think you'd see similar contradictions in terms of Asia. They're a little bit more clarity. He would expect a lot more military spending from Japan and South Korea and Taiwan, or at least tell them, if you're worried about Chinese influence in the region, you need to do a lot more to do something about that. You have the wealth, you just don't have the political will to spend more for your own defense. He's made that very clear, and it would not surprise me if he implemented that early, to be able to show his base, we're pulling out American troops, we're allowing Japan, this very wealthy society, South Korea, this very wealthy society, Taiwan, this very wealthy society, to do a lot more for their defense. The big fear of that, of course, is what we'll see in that region then is a classic arms race. Japan, South Korea, Taiwan will begin to militarize much more substantially. Of course, China will respond. And then, of course, these countries will respond. And we'll see a classic. And there's a lot of literature about this. We have Chinese and American scholars, for example, coming together at Harvard, University of California, Berkeley, Princeton, in Beijing, in Shanghai, coming together
and holding conference after conference looking at European history in the period 1912 to 1914, and how in the absence of a large power that's able to regulate an arms race, Germany, France, and Britain in an arms race miscalculated each other's intentions. And so the Chinese are studying, for example, summer 1914 intensely about how to avoid miscommunication based on a regional arms race. And in terms of Europe, last I would say, Donald Trump would say the exact same thing to Europe. And he's saying that, and it's an enormously popular message in the United States. He's saying, NATO, EU, EU's the richest region in the world. Europe has more than enough money. If it's worried about Russia, let it double its military spending. It certainly has the wealth, it just doesn't have the political will. So European elites are deeply nervous about Donald Trump in that sense. If he won and he pursued that message, and I would predict he would, because that's been part of his core message in terms of his clientele, that would confront Europe next year with some big decisions, big decisions. And for example, that would impact Germany's budget fundamentally. Germany's talking about spending 1.2, 1.3% of its national budget on military costs. It's supposed to be spending 2%. But that assumes the United States is strongly committed to NATO. If it's not, that number might have to change to 2.5%. That would mean tens of billions of euros potentially would have to come from somewhere else. Where? And that those would be issues for next year, 2017, 2018. And how do you discuss those things in election season? So Donald Trump could shake up transatlantic security politics deeply and quickly if he won. That would be that would not surprise me, let me put it that way. Yes?
So I'm curious about one of the things you mentioned, that Donald Trump, you read him as symptomatic of a broader problem in American society, so to say. And you also, at the same time, in a certain way, bound him with Bernie Sanders together in a way that seems to make sense. Both of them are from outside of the parties. Both of them mounted very conservative campaigns using people that normally weren't necessarily involved in the primary. And, of course, socially, the two are about as far apart as possible in American politics, but economically they are relatively similar, especially when it comes to trade. And I'm curious, to what extent do you think that Trump and Bernie Trump is symptomatic of the general neoliberal consensus among the two parties? Because economically, of course, Bill Clinton, in 1992, ran from the right of the General Democratic Party, leaving behind the, so to say, social democratic legacy of FDR. And I'm kind of curious, do you think that is a serious driving force behind Donald Trump and Bernie's support? And do you think that is kind of what the American political system got by refusing to engage with questions of political economy particularly seriously inside the small bounds of debate that are prescribed by the two parties?
It's a great question. So, you know, the question is, in terms of Donald Trump and Bernie Sanders, are they a reflection of the fact that a type of neoliberal narrative has really captured American political economy over the last quarter centuries and made it much more difficult to think of alternative models? In many ways, we've seen buy-in from not just the Bushes, which you might generally anticipate, but also the Clintons, both Bill and Hillary. And I think that's a frankly, a profoundly important question. And let me make clear, when I talk about populism and Donald Trump and Bernie Sanders, I'm talking about sociological phenomenon. The two people could not be more different in terms of individual character, integrity, and what they stand for. I could see myself voting for Bernie Sanders. Donald Trump, I don't need to talk about. But if we're as an analytical observation, yes, I would agree with you. They are both phenomenon of the fact that the U.S. importantly has not sufficiently engaged the consequences of let's say, I'm not going to say globalization, I'll say economic transformation. Part of it is trade, for example, neoliberalism, neoliberalization. We can talk some more about that. But just as fundamentally, for example, is simply the introduction of new forms of technology that have churned and upended old patterns of work in American society.
So if you were to ask me concretely, what's been more disruptive in the last quarter century, neoliberalism or technology? Scholars will debate that. They will debate that fundamentally. Just as in terms of the late 19th century, in terms of the steam engine, for example, and electricity, in terms of forms of technology and disruption and patterns of living. Whether it's populism in Europe or populism in North America, what voters are reacting to are different forms of deep disruption in daily life. Economic, social, but also cultural. And technology plays a large role in this. Now, neoliberalization in terms of what it has done to American society has clearly been part of this. The neoliberal story for American society is also more complicated. It really starts in the 1970s and with the Democratic Party. We tend to forget, you know, the Democrats started the neoliberal agenda in the late 1970s because the American economy had reached a point of such standstill that Jimmy Carter, as a Democrat, began really dismantling, as you pointed out correctly, sort of the welfare state that Franklin Roosevelt helped establish. American top tax rates in America up through the early 1970s on top incomes was 70%. 70%. We forget that. And Democrats supported that, and Republicans supported that. You know? Richard Nixon supported that. So, you know, there was a welfare state, if you will, or a social contract in America supported by Republicans and Democrats through the mid-70s. The problem became that the economy was on long-term decline and what to do about that. So Jimmy Carter broke up the trucking industry. He broke up the airline industry. He began passing laws that made it hard to have a sort of a Fordist regulatory type of state. And you're absolutely right. Bill Clinton continued that agenda and continued that agenda. I would say America is deeply divided if they actually want a stronger regulatory state. I think we see that in opinion polls, even among Democrats. Maybe that's America's sort of neurotic political personality. But you know, when I talk to Europeans, say, how is it possible that Americans are almost evenly divided about Obamacare? You know, in Europe, that'd be a 90% would be for an institution like that. And a lot of it has to do with simply to what extent should the state be involved in regulating societal disruption. One area you see clear support, and Hillary Clinton would do this as much as Donald Trump, it shows you it's difficult to place them ideologically, are the costs of neoliberalism in terms of trade. So Donald Trump has talked about supporting workers a lot more in terms of certain programs, maybe like you know Germany does in terms of re-education and retraining. So does that make Donald Trump a populist, a socialist, a Democrat? Who knows, right? I would say Donald Trump would go after Obamacare, but I don't think he would go over, he certainly wouldn't go after Social Security. I don't think he'd go after a lot of programs. America has a very robust welfare state. It's just structured differently than Europe. A lot runs through the tax code, a lot runs through local state initiatives. If you look at, depending on how you want to define welfare spending, if you look at total welfare spending in the United States, in terms of different programs from food stamps to income support programs, it's not that far behind societies like Germany or France. Depends how you want to measure it. It's just structured differently. So, but neoliberalism in terms of a liberal economy and its disruptions overall, yeah, very much so. And that's why Bernie Sanders and someone like Elizabeth Warren now are so powerful. If Hillary Clinton wins, it wouldn't surprise me if Bernie Sanders became, for example, Secretary of Labor. I said, okay, Mr. Sanders, here's your chance. Let's make some real changes. And Elizabeth Warren, perhaps, Secretary of the Treasury, maybe? It's a powerful position, but then she could really bring in her ideas about consumer rights and fairness into basic financial policy. That's not science fiction. So, and that's towards your question in terms of really addressing that and the real perception of that. It's a really good question. Other questions, critique, things I have not talked about,
things you'd like to talk about? That's a great question. If Republicans, what will Congress look like? And let's say the Democrats have a good chance to have a majority in the Senate. The House of Representatives will most likely remain Republican. We'll have to see what kind of Republican Party we have after this election. We're hearing more and more discussion about really Donald Trump's candidacy is sort of the death knell of the Republican Party as we have known it, you know, for the past decades. Not the first time in American history where sort of so-called conservative movement has split around a fundamental issue. The Republican Party emerged as a party as the former Whig Party fell apart in the 1850s over slavery, for example. The two parties then were the Democrats and the Whigs simply did not survive the internal division within that. Then Abraham Lincoln and so-called Republicans emerged from that. We might see something happen like that here. That's a realistic possibility. We might see, in relatively rapid fashion, the rearrangement of the American political landscape. So for example, it's not science fiction in terms of Congress, in terms of national politics, where we could see so-called a type of center in American politics. Moderate Republicans and conservative Democrats, for example. This is exactly how the Republican Party emerged. The Republican Party in the 1850s took voters from the former Whigs, but also from the Democrats, who are more moderate, and brought them together into the Republican Party. That's a possibility starting next year. I don't know what the party would be called. And then the other party could be sort of, again, a more populist, protest, national populist party, taking deeply disaffected Republicans and angry Republicans, along with Reagan Democrats, deeply disaffected Democrats and angry Democrats, say, you know, we need truly national solutions for our problems right now. And this could create a new powerful type of protest populist party versus a more moderate centrist party. That is absolutely possible. It's not complete science fiction. So the role of Congress is central. I'd like to say provocatively, American presidents are much weaker than German chancellors in terms of real party, in terms of real power, right? You have a majority in the parliament. You have tight party discipline in Germany. Chancellors also have to fight for authority, but institutionally, they're much more stable and predictable and powerful institutionally. Barack Obama doesn't know where his Democratic Party is going to go. That's weak party. They feel no direct loyalty to the president. As we say, we have 535 sort of independent agents in the U.S. Congress between the House of Representatives and the Senate. Much weaker parties, much stronger sense of individual obligation to a constituency and to oneself. Presidents are always fighting to keep intact majorities for initiatives within their own party, let alone in the opposition. So we'll see where the Republican Party is. You know, if Donald Trump wins, that could, for example, speed up the demise of the Republican Party, where many Republicans just say, morally and ethically, I am not going to support that president as a Republican. I'll talk to fellow Democrats of a certain, you know, political color and other Republicans and see what we can do here to start a new movement. That would surprise me less, to be honest with you. It's a very important question. Congress could really speed up the restructuring of the American political landscape through being confronted by certain choices. And if Hillary Clinton wins, I think Republicans now are so loathed, even within their own party, that they'll realize that another 4 years or 8 years of simply saying no, is just not going to cut anymore. That, in part, Republicans internally have realized that constantly saying no the way they have was a real Faustian bargain. Because we see this in polls and studies. That strategy, or Pyrrhic victory, if you will, is what in part played an important role in radicalizing the base of the Republican Party. And, you know, as a writer for the Washington Post put it, to mix my metaphors, you know, the Republican Party created its own Frankenstein. They were the scientists through the way that they tried to manipulate the legislative system. They only had themselves to blame. And they're realizing that increasingly. Other questions? Foreign policy, domestic, things I haven't talked about? We have time for maybe one more question? Yes, sir.
Do you believe in American political dynasties?
Do I believe in American political dynasties? As long as they're the right ones. No, that's not a serious answer. They're there. America has always had elites. It goes way back to the 18th and 19th century, the Adams family. And we've seen them again and again, moderate Democrats, conservatives, the Adams family, the Roosevelt family, the Kennedy family, the Clinton family, the Bush family. Now, if you just take those five, you'll notice three out of those five are Democratic dynasties. So dynasties are not conservative or progressive. Dynasties are about, first of all, in terms of the White House, how enormously complicated it is to enter the White House, and the degree to which you need elites and networks. We're having serious discussions about Michelle Obama running in maybe 4 to 8 years. The movement to nominate Michelle Obama is already underway. And she has, if she would want to do that, she has excellent chances. Why? Not because of the dynasty, but because she's clearly embedded in an elite structure in American society. She has access to finance. She has access to media. She has access to political lobby groups. She has access to party sort of leadership. Right? These are all the things you need to win the White House. So you clearly have political elites in every society. Sometimes I hear from German friends and colleagues, we don't really have an elite like that here in this country. So you're not looking hard enough. And in terms of American politics, it's certainly there. And you see again, it's not left or right. It's sort of the structures around which American politics at that level is organized. Thank you very much for coming tonight. Thank you very much for your excellent questions. We will know in 5 days. I find that pretty exciting and makes me pretty nervous, but that's the beauty of democracy and competitive elections. So thanks for coming tonight, and I'll see you soon.